Now you are watching my amateur film entitled ELE 452 course, which is Fundamentals of Medical Imaging Systems. This is a makeup lecture held on 3rd March 2014, Monday, and the topic of this film is related to X-ray imaging systems, specifically some electromagnetic spectrum, X-ray generation, X-ray and matter interaction, Compton scattering, photoelectric scattering, and X-ray generation, some systems, tubes, etc., and imaging systems in general. Now we are starting with the table 1 from your lecture book, and this table shows the electromagnetic wave spectrum. There are 4 columns. 3 columns are consisting numbers and 1 column consists of some wording. The first column is on the left side, shows the energy in electron volts. As you remember, electron volt is an energy unit, which is the kinetic energy gained by one electron under 1 volt potential difference. The next column shows the frequencies related to that energy levels. As you know, subatomic particles do have wave properties, and their frequency is related to their energy by Planck's constant. The rightmost column includes the or shows the wavelength in meters, and of course each frequency is related to wavelength, and they are related to each other by the velocity of the wave, which is the velocity of light. Now the third column, which is from text, is oriented on the third column, and from the upper part we read AM radio waves, short radio waves, FM radio waves, and TV microwaves and radar, infrared light, visible light, ultraviolet light, and then comes X-ray. X-ray is our fundamental concern, and it's a specific band of frequencies and wavelengths of the photons or light particles, and their energies are usually in between 20 kilo electron volts up to 150 kilo electron volts for medical systems. These are shown inside that red rectangle towards the left part of the X-ray term and on the table. And corresponding frequencies are shown on the right side.
X-ray is a, basically it's a waveform, so it can be represented as a mathematical function where the horizontal axis is time and the vertical axis is the intensity. The waveform is sinusoidal, and a period of this waveform is defined such that the same value of intensity is passed over one period. This period is as a unit of time. The intensity has a peak value and peak to peak value, as you know, and the frequency of this waveform is the inverse of its period and expressed as 1 over t. Now let's concentrate on an example, which is the same example as found in the textbook. The example says that consider an X-ray photon with
Now let's concentrate on X-ray and matter interaction, because we have created an X-ray photon and calculate its energy, etc. Now let's see. Well, now we see an X-ray photon is coming towards an atom, and we assume that there's a nucleus and surrounding electrons. The interaction of this photon with that atom could be, in the first choice, so-called coherent scattering of an X-ray photon by an atom. Now, the mechanism is such that the incident X-ray photon comes and directly interacts with the electron, and it's scattered. So the electron does not leave its orbit. It continues its rotation. But of course, some energy is transferred to electron, and this energy is not enough for the electron to change its orbit. But the X-ray photon is scattered, so loses some of its energy and continues its way forward. Now we come to the second type of X-ray and matter interaction. This is called characteristic radiation. The characteristic radiation is the interaction between the X-ray photon and especially inner side or inner radius shells, electrons. And the X-ray photon hits these electrons and moves them out of their shells. So the electron moves to upper shells and then returns back. Either itself or some other neighboring electrons fill that empty vacancy, so that another X-ray photon is created by this electron shell movement. These frequencies are very, very specific, as you remember from last lecture's iodine example. KLM shells and corresponding electrons movement between among these shells result in specific frequency radiation, so-called characteristic radiation. This characteristic radiation in that curve is shown as the X-ray intensity in the tube. That means the X-ray tube creates lots of photons with different energies. Towards left side, lower energy photons are created, and towards right side, in decreasing number, linearly decreasing number, higher energy photons are created. And the characteristic radiation peaks are observed around 60, 70, 80 kilo electron volts, which are denoted by alpha 1, alpha 2, beta 1, beta 2, etc. That means from K to L, L to M, K to M kind of orbital electron interchanges. They result in characteristic X-ray photon producing after this interaction. Now on the characteristics, we see another curve due to white radiation. This white radiation is another type of X-ray photon creation by means of electron and matter interaction. When the electrons are accelerated, as we see in the X-ray tube, when they are accelerated and approaching towards the atom, they are accelerating or attracted by the nucleus, but they do not collide with any electron or nucleus, rather they change their direction as shown. So incoming electron is marked with little square, red square. That electron is approaching and going through a couple of electrons and close to nucleus, etc. Then of course the path of the electron due to that interaction with the charge centers of the atom
the direction of the movement changes, and of course the momentum and the energy of this electron also changes. Now the resultant electron position and direction of movement is different, as marked with another red little rectangle in the figure. Now the electron from the initial state to the final state, of course its energy changes, and this energy results in a photon creation as shown like a waveform in the figure. That photon is due to white radiation. So the direction of the electron changes as it passes through the charges inside the atom. Due to that change, energy of it also changes and photon is created, and this is called white radiation. Now we come one of the most important interactions between X-ray photon and electrons. This is called photoelectric effect. Photoelectric effect includes one photon and one electron. Simply, in the figure we see the atom, an incoming X-ray photon, and the incoming X-ray photon is approaching to the atom as marked with a red rectangle, and it has of course an energy and a momentum approaching to the electron in one of the orbits of the atom. And this interaction creates an energy change. Hitting this inner electron by this X-ray photon may result in complete outward going of the electron, so that is called photoelectron. And you see there is a vacancy behind this electron. So this vacancy may attract neighboring electrons. These neighboring electrons may jump into inner shells and release their energy. That release of energy results in X-ray photon generation. And between specific K or L or M shells, as we described, this is called characteristic radiation. Now one other X-ray photon and matter interaction, and very frequently encountered one, is Compton scattering, so-called Compton scattering. This Compton scattering occurs, of course, when incident X-ray photon incoming and hitting usually an outermost shell electron, and the photon does not disappear, it continues its way towards another direction. So it loses some of its energy, and the X-ray photon, as shown with red rectangle, is coming towards the atom. It misses the inner side shell electrons, so characteristic radiation does not occur. Rather, it directs to outermost shell electrons. And this shell electron, of course, receives some of the photon's energy, and the X-ray photon is scattered. The scattering angle is given as theta, so the original direction is no longer valid. The photon is deflected, and electron receives some energy and leaves the orbit, gains some energy to ionize the atom. So electron moves in different direction.
Now, of course, the photon loses its energy, and initial energy capital E drops to capital E prime, and the formula of this energy change is given under the figure. The numerator is your initial energy, numerator is 1 plus E over mc square times 1 minus cosine theta. Cosine theta is related to the deflection angle. Now let's try to illustrate characteristic radiation in different inner orbits. Assume this is the nucleus of iodine atom as given in the book, and we have the closest orbital or closest shell with two electrons, namely, and then the next shell is also drawn. This is the second inner shell. Assume we have one electron as indicated. Of course, we do have many electrons, but only one electron is shown for simplicity. Assume we have the third shell, which corresponds to the third energy level of the atom, and this atom is iodine once again. And simplistically, we have the fourth shell, denoting the fourth different energy level around the atom. Assume the electron is over there. Doesn't matter where it is, because the difference of the energies is important. Now let's mark the orbitals as K, L, M, N. So innermost electron as orbital is K. And assume an X-ray photon is coming and directly hitting the electron at the K-th shell, and the electron leaves its place and leaves a vacancy behind. So all X-ray photon energy is transferred to the electron, and the electron is free from the atom. Now there are three choices. Three neighboring atoms, one of them may fill in this vacancy. The option one, from the orbital L to K, the electron moves from L to K, and the amount of energy released from that movement is 28.3 kilo electron volts. So that energy results in a photon having an energy of 28.3 kilo electron volts. Now you can, of course, calculate the wavelength of this electron by using Planck's equation. The second alternative is an electron from M shell fills in the vacancy at the K-th shell, and the difference of energy is 32.6 kilo electron volts. And the last choice is electron moves from shell N to K, which results in a photon release of 33.2 kilo electron volts. Now this interaction with matter has been defined by using single photons, single electrons, one atom, etc., etc. Of course, the interaction changes with respect to photon energy, and of course the interaction also varies with respect to the density of the material. Now usually the characteristics and the attenuation between or among the X-ray and matter is expressed as a curve, and because it varies with respect to photon energy. These curves are called mass attenuation coefficients curves, and several media as shown in the figure are shown, like lead and iodine and some tissues like bone, fat and muscle. And horizontal axis is X-ray photon energy in kiloelectron volts. And the medical diagnostic systems, the range of X-ray photons vary from 20 kiloelectron volts to 150 kiloelectron volts. And the mass attenuation coefficient units, unit is given centimeter squared over grams, or meter squared over kilograms, etc. But usually in the size or scale of the living things, centimeter squared over grams is the optimum choice. So as you see, the attenuation coefficient is higher for lower X-ray energies. So that means lower X-ray energies are scattered or absorbed more than higher energies. Higher energy photons are less scattered. They penetrate through the body or the matter more than the lower energy X-rays. And of course, the X-ray photon energy marked with red rectangle denotes medical range of X-ray energies. Now let's analyze attenuation. Attenuation naturally results in X-ray photon and matter interaction and absorption. So X-ray enters the material, which is a block or bulk thing full of atoms, crystals, etc. And of course, some part of this X-ray leaves that material, and this has a reduced intensity. So what's happening inside this material is absorption. So absorption occurs in the material, and reduced intensity X-ray leaves the material. Try to find a method to explain this, and attenuation results in the reduced intensity X-ray coming out of the material due to absorption in the material. Now let's try to analyze this in a little bit more mathematical concepts. Now I'm drawing the material. This material, assume, has rectangular prism shape with a thickness X, and X-ray photons are perpendicular to that material. With a finite thickness and cross-section area, like shown in an elliptical or cylindrical geometry, and this red boundary is full of X-ray photons, and this is called an X-ray beam. And this beam has a cross-sectional area capital A, and X-ray photons are uniformly distributed inside that cross-sectional area A. Now I am marking some illustrative atoms of the material randomly and uniformly distributed inside the material, and assume each atom has a cross-sectional area, assume it's circular cross-sectional area of sigma. So these little sigma areas are mostly capturing X-ray photons by means of photoelectric effects, Compton scattering, coherent scattering, and related X-ray electron interaction. Now the atoms are sparsely distributed inside that material. We assume there are lowercase n atoms per unit volume of this material.
atoms, X-rays can freely travel, but towards the atoms they certainly interact. So capital A times N results in total number of atoms inside that X-ray beam. Or in other words, atoms encountered in this cross-sectional area, like the ones marked, are marked with n a times n. And if we multiply this term by sigma, which is per atom area, then this number results in the total area of encountered atoms within that beam. Now we continue our derivation. We can think of a probability of encountering with X-ray and matter atoms. So this probability is the total area of the atoms versus the total area of the beam incident on the material, which gives n times sigma.
Beta or 0.693 over beta. Now there are important definitions of Röntgen. The Röntgen is related to the radiation, and one unit Röntgen is a measure of X-ray energy. That's the product of power contained in the beam and time of exposure, and is defined as the total number of ion pairs produced in 1 cm³ of air under standard conditions. Standard conditions means that 760 mm mercury pressure and 0°C ambient temperature, and this radiation in the air creates an electric charge separation or ionization of 2.58 times 10 to the minus 4 coulomb per kilogram of air. If that ionization is realized, then that means our X-ray exposure is 1 Röntgen. Now of course exposure is not enough. We should have material or tissue absorption. Absorption means the energy is deposited in the material. So there is another measure for that deposit in the material. That deposit is measured by the unit of RAD or RADs or Röntgen absorbed dose. The first letters of these three letters, radiation absorbed dose of RAD. This unit defines the amount of radiation actually absorbed by a medium. A RAD means that 0.01 joule of energy is absorbed by 1 kilogram of that material. Now our next topic is related to the generation of X-rays. One of the most simple method to generate is, of course, we have to have accelerated electrons hitting large atoms, usually tungsten atoms, and these electrons are originating from the filament of a heated filament of so-called cathode of the tube. They are targeted towards the anode with a very high voltage, and this voltage is on the order of 20,000 to 150,000 volts, which is the medical diagnostic X-ray spectrum voltages. And they hit a little tilted anode surface to have a narrower beam for focusing. Actually, the tubes are designed such that they send a large cross-section area towards the anode surface, and due to the tilt angle of this surface, the beam is narrowed down to have a better or sharper, more focused image imaging output.